has been so weird. It's been so weird. I woke up this morning and it was snowing. And then like an hour later, it was raining. And then it was sunny. And then it was snowing again. Then it was raining. Now it's like somewhat clear outside. I don't understand. I don't get the weather at all. But what's going on, guys? And welcome back to the channel. So today I'm going to talk to you guys about how much it cost me to get this car where it is today, making 457 wheel horsepower, 393 foot-pounds of torque from the condition that I bought it in. Now, when we get into that, we're gonna get into that in a minute. I got a couple things that I gotta knock out on this 05 STI right here in front of me. The speakers in it are just trash. I don't know who had the car before me. Don't know what they did. They cheaped out on a lot of stuff. Gotta swap out these speakers. Went to Best Buy, bought some like $200, like somewhat decent ones. Hopefully we can get those in the car, or actually we're gonna get those in the car, and hopefully that fixes the speaker problem. But normally I would just pull the car in the garage, but as you can see behind me, the Neon is in here right now. Should be off jack stands out of the garage here soon, like going to fab and whatnot. Matt's got a whole bunch of stuff going on with that. But let's toss these things into that. Come on, unlock. I need to get a new key fob for this thing. Come on, come on. One more, give me one more. There we go. There we go. These kind of fit. These look deeper. I swear, if these don't fit, I'm gonna be a little upset. Like, what in the hell? I don't know what I'm doing, so hold up. Okay, I'm back. Speakers, not my thing, not my thing. The rear ones, no problem. Got those ones in, no problem. They went in just fine, but the fronts, not a chance. Not a chance, not a chance. Not a chance. I got the right diameter, but the depth of them, whoo-hoo, way too deep, way too deep. Hits the window when it's down. Doesn't work. Just doesn't work at all. Problem right there, that's the old one. That's the new one. Yeah, these are a little, I'm gonna go to Car Toys and get something else. These I'll just return to Best Buy. Sucks I couldn't use them, but it is what it is. Let's get into talking about this turd now. All right, so I got my handy dandy phone over there with all the cost and all the prices of everything and whatnot. So there's two different numbers for this car. The first one is everything that's done to it and the total cost of that if one of you guys wanted to replicate something like this. And this is all MSRP pricing. But remember, when I bought the car, it came with the Type RA short block, came with the cams, came with the intake. All I did was replace the post-MAF hose, came with some other parts that we did end up reusing. So I'm not factoring that cost into what I spent because I didn't spend the money on that. So kind of what we did here, if you guys remember, here's like a quick like B-roll as I'm talking of when we got the car. Total mess of the engine bay. There were sensors missing. There were wiring looms just ratted out and destroyed. There was oil leaking from every orifice in this thing. So we had to go through, we had to do a lot of just OEM repair stuff. Now, if you're looking at just like OEM repair stuff, like power steering pump, random gaskets, what else do we have on here? New window regulator, broken interior panels, the AVCS cam gear that I messed up, the new oil control valves, and the machine shop cost for the block, that came in at a total of $1,925 for like OEM replacement stuff, gaskets, power steering pump, machine shop cost to resurface the heads, recut valve seats, everything like that. So that was just shy of $2,000, not even in aftermarket parts. That's just machine shop cost, OEM stuff. Now, if you really want to get into the total cost of absolutely everything in here, hold up, I'm gonna throw this thing on a tripod. Okay, this works a little bit better because now I can actually like give you guys the cost as I'm going through this. So like I said, I'll run through the entire parts list. I'll have everything down below in the description for if any of you guys do want to replicate this build. But just starting with electronics, COB access port, steady $675, pretty standard. SF intake, another $225. Intake box on top of that because we don't want our IATs being super high, another $135. Remember, this is everything that's done to the car. This is not what I paid because it did come with some of these parts, and I'll give you those two costs at the end. FP 84 millimeter turbo inlet, another $250. Pretty solid turbo inlet. A lot of people were saying fitment issues with that were gonna be awful. Really not that bad. Really not as bad as people made it out to be. We are using the FP black with the 10 centimeter upgrade over the 8 centimeter, and we have the journal bearing model. It's not the ball bearing model. COB front mount intercooler. It's really not the one that I wanted to get for the car. I really wanted ETS, but they were on like extreme back order. And with some of the all over the placeness of, hey, we might have a tune here, we might have a tune there. It's what was available. It's what was in stock. No complaints with it. Fitment on it is solid. So no problems with that. We did do the Visconti tuning hybrid speed density kit as well. It still retains the MAF, just relocates the IAT sensor right before the throttle body and the intake piping. COB four bar MAP sensor, just because we're gonna be running more boost. V3 IAG AOS, we're all about that reliability here. Get a Dom cylinder four cooling mod, reliability stuff. Mishimoto radiator came with the car, another $293. Killer B dual reservoir tank that houses coolant
and washer fluid, so that way you can retain both of those. That's another $329. Chase Bay's power steering system. So the power steering system on this car was so trash when I bought this thing. All of the lines for the power steering system in general, they were dry rotted. Some of them were leaking. The power steering pump was leaking, which is why we went with an OEM replacement on that. So that came in at about another $330. It's a really good power steering system. It sucks to bleed. Like, it really does suck to bleed quite a bit. More reliability stuff, Killer Bee oil pan, baffle, pickup, all like the kit and caboodle with that one, because you guys know I'm all about the reliability stuff. Cobb LF bypass valve, that's what I run in all my cars. IAG TGV deletes. Good luck trying to find those nowadays. I think IAG is the only vendor who's actually selling them. I don't know how much longer they're going to be selling them with the whole EPA stuff going on. We're also running their 8mm phenolic spacers just to help with clearance on the actual turbo inlet there. Now, as for the fuel system, This saved me a little bit of money here, because with the gray STI right there, we are running ID1300s in that car. But when I bought the injectors for that one, I accidentally used the part number for this chassis when it was a different injector that I needed. So I already had six of them laying around. I'd end up selling four of them, so I had two. So I only had to buy two ID1300s from ID, which was significantly cheaper. But if you're buying a brand new set of ID1300s, it comes in at about $900. I think I paid around $300 or so for two ID1300s, if I remember correctly. We do have the AEM 340 liter per hour fuel pump. If you're looking for one of those, it's another like $116 or so. Aeromotive A1000 with the IAG gauge. What is the gauge called? Analog gauge, just to tell us fuel pressure, so that way if we ever have a fuel issue, we can just reference the gauge, see what's going on. Definitely handy to have in there. As for the exhaust setup, because I know a lot of you guys are gonna be asking for that one, we have the Killer Bee Holy Header on the car. It's my go-to header for all of my builds, all of my STIs. The Killer Bee Holy Header is the one I always get. I've wanted to try the ETS Big Tube one, but the lead times on those are a little out there. Plus, I don't know about fitment on them. Even with the Killer Bee one, I had to do some modification to the chassis to actually make it fit without smacking the front lower core support, but it fits nicely, makes good power. We do have the Grimsby 38mm external wastegate up pipe. Good luck finding one of those also, because I'm pretty sure all of those are discontinued at this point. If you're trying to find one, they're gonna be like gold. On that up pipe, we do have the Tile 38mm MVS external wastegate, the same one I ran in the 17 STI over there, except for we had a 44 rather than a 38. If you're looking at that wastegate combo, I believe it comes in at about $685, $700, somewhere in that range if you buy them together. For the downpipe, we do have a Grimspeed catted downpipe. It is their basic downpipe. It is not the downpipe that I wanted to run on the car, but everything else was just extremely out of stock whenever it came to trying to find any of this stuff, so that is what I was able to get. No complaints with it. It sounds good. It is catted, so I mean, it still meets emission standards and it still works as it should. The car did come with a Greddy catback. It's not my catback of choice, but I actually don't mind it. It sounds pretty good. It sounds healthy. There's no broken welds on it. There's no broken exhaust hangers. Has a muffler on it, which actually does help a lot with sound. And I think this STI sounds a lot better than that 17 did. The 17 sounded very trumpety and very raspy. Very raspy. Power. Something to be able to hold the power. So we needed a clutch, we needed a flywheel. The clutch and flywheel on this car were going out when I bought it. They were just OEM exit-y in there. So I decided to go with ACT. We have their ACT HDSS clutch in there. I think it's rated up to like 550 foot-pounds of torque. So it should hold our torque no problem with the setup on that. I also do have their street light flywheel, just because I didn't want to resurface and reuse the old OEM flywheel. You can definitely do that if you're trying to save a little bit of money. But that combo right there is pretty good. If you're looking at that, the clutch comes in at about $625 and the flywheel comes in at about another $357. The mounts on this car, total trash. One motor mount was blown out completely. The transmission mount was blown out. So we swapped all of those. We went with Group N engine mounts and transmission mounts. The Group N engine mounts came in at about $140. The transmission mount came in at about another $100. So not too bad for engine mounts and transmission mounts. The Group N, it's very good for daily driving also. It's not like incredibly stiff. It still like gives you good feedback from the car. It's like, it's in between like stock OEM and an aftermarket replacement. So the Group N, very good way to go. And then for the heads, because we do have built heads on this car, the car did come with Brian Crower 272 cams. That was quite the find when I popped open the valve cover and found those cams. With those cams came a lot of work to actually make them work. But we do have Brian Crower 272 cams. We have Brian Crower valve springs. I just went with their steel ones. They're bare, basic steel standard valve springs. Didn't see a need for the beehive ones. valves. We had four bent intake valves on the driver's head over here, so we did need to replace all the valves. So I was able, only because it's what they had in stock, I was able to snag a set of Manly Performance intake and exhaust valves. They are stock size, there's no porting done to these heads at all. Stock heads just built. And then we have the GSC Viton valve seals, GSC valve guides, both intake and exhaust, and then the GSC valve retainer seats for the springs. Skipped past it, Cobb 3-port boost controller. Get any boost controller you want out there. It comes in at about $115 for the boost controller. For the head, since I didn't really average that cost out, the cams came in at $750, valve springs $165, intake and exhaust valves were $161 for each set. Viton valve seals $13. That's probably the highest ticket item on this car. Valve guides came in at about $40 intake, $40 exhaust, so about $82.50 there for both of them. And then the valve seats for the springs were another like $20, so not too bad. While we did have it apart, we obviously needed to swap the head gasket, so I snagged a set of Tomei head gaskets. I believe I went with the 0.70 for thickness, if I remember correctly. Those came in at about another $110 or so. And then with some of the other like heat management stuff, the turbo obviously needed a turbo blanket, so we did grab the PTP turbo blanket. And then for some of the other supporting mods, we did get the fluid damper crank pulley. That comes in at about another $486, IAG oil feed kit for the turbo, and then inside of the car, the SMY gauge cluster, both boost and AFR gauges, so that way we could monitor what all our motor was doing. Now, like I said, this is not cheap. And then obviously the Type RA short block, that did come in the car. I did a lot of research trying to figure out what the hell was the short block was when we got the car. Did verify it was a Type RA, that is not a cheap one either. But if you're looking at just MSRP cost on all of these modifications to 100% cut, copy, paste this build right here, total cost, woo, came in at about $17,375.30. Luckily, I did not pay anywhere near that because a lot of the modifications that we reused, I either had from the 17 STI or it did come with this car. So what I ended up spending just on aftermarket parts was about $9,711.05, significantly less, like $8,000 less. So just shy of, well, I guess if you want to factor in all the OEM replacement stuff that I bought and the machine shop, it came in at about $11,600. But if you compare it over to that gray STI over there, I think I spent about $13,250 on that one for it to make about 401 wheel horsepower. So the price per horsepower on this car is a lot better than that one. It definitely did help that this car did come with that short block. That short block comes in at about, I don't know, what was it, $2,200 or so for a Type RA short block. So having a lot of these modifications on the car severely saved me, what, $8,000 or so, including the price of the short block in there. And with the help of the people who did support this build, New School Performance, Fluid Damper, Killer B, Connor, whole bunch of support went into this build. If it wasn't for you guys, I honestly don't think the car would be at the level that it's at. I think I would have just saved a stock turbo, stock top mount intercooler, all of the stock things there. But it's not cheap. Modifying Subarus and fixing up old ones like this is not cheap. And this car is not done yet either. There's still more things that I need to replace, both OEM and aftermarket, to get it where I want it to. I hope this gives you guys a more realistic representation to how much it actually costs to do this stuff. Subarus are not cheap cars to build. They're not for the faint of heart if you want a lot of power to go in a straight line. This is not a straight line car. It's a car that I try to shoot for overall balance with. I want the car to be able to handle exceptionally well. If you want, I didn't even factor it in, the coilovers, the roll center adjustment kit, the new ball joints, that kind of stuff. I didn't even factor those in. That's probably another $1,100 or so. But coupons, I found some coupons for those ones. But honestly, it's a car that's all about balance. It's not a car that's built to go in a straight line, stupid fast. That's not what this car is about. That's not what I built it for. It's not what I want out of it. There's still more suspension stuff that I want to do to this thing, such as sway bars, end links, chassis bracing, exterior things. I need new headlights because these ones just drink water whenever it rains and whenever I wash the car. So there's still a lot to go with this thing to get it exactly where I want it to. But a lot of you guys ask me like, hey, is it affordable to build Subaru? Is it cheap to build one to make it go fast? Can I hit 400 wheel horsepower with a budget of $4,000? No, not doing it reliably at least. And I said this in the last video that I did one of these breakdowns on, is not cheap. It's not cheap, and there's always different avenues and different ways you can go to make horsepower. This is the avenue and the route that I decided to go with this car, and I'm exceptionally happy with the way that this aspect of things turned out, like the motor right now. We still have what body stuff to do, interior stuff to do. The car needs to get tinted. There's a ton more that still has to happen on this car. The speakers! I still gotta buy new speakers today and return those ones because they didn't fit. But I hope this guys get, I hope this gives you guys like a solid breakdown. Oh, and the timing kit, if you wanna, I didn't name that one, but that one factored into OEM parts also. But I hope this guys, or I hope this gives you guys a more realistic breakdown of how much it actually costs to make power with these things.
But like I said, I would not have built this car any other way, for the motor at least. Like, this is what I'm exceptionally happy with. Wouldn't have it any other way. The engine bay is exceptionally clean. I would like to do a couple small dress up things, like swap out like yellow stuff, get rid of that, actually get hood struts so I'm not having to use a hood prop all the time. It's just all of this stuff. I'm so exceptionally happy with the way that this car turned out. And I really do hope this answers your guys' questions about what all is exactly done to this build. I didn't even factor in the IAG fuel rails. I forgot I had those in there. Add that to the, I think that's actually in the, that's actually not in the total cost of things for those fuel rails. I think those are another $150 or so, but see, I mean, there's small stuff here and there that I was forgetting, but it averages out to about what I said. So I hope this does help you guys out in the questions that you guys had regarding what all is done to the engine, how much it cost me, and all of that kind of stuff. Coming up here soon, well, coming up here in a couple days, this car is going back in the garage. We need to continue stripping down the 2017 STI to get it ready for the EG33. I have no updates from Outfront right now. The last thing that I heard was that they're fighting with FedEx to get FedEx to approve the claim that happened on the motor in transport when it got damaged and kind of destroyed. So hopefully something happens here soon, because I can't be on standby forever waiting for that EG33 to come back for this guy, because I want to get this car running this year. That is my goal. There's so much work that has to go into this, fabrication, lead times, all of this other stuff that I cannot be waiting forever. So hopefully that gets resolved here soon. This STI will go back in the garage. We'll start tearing that one apart more. This one's gonna get some exterior work done to it. We're gonna be taking this car up to the track. Need some tires before we actually get it up there. It is gonna go up to the mountains to have some fun, spirited driving times. But anyways, that's all I got for you guys on this one. So if you liked the video, if it helped you, if it answered your questions, you know what to do. Go ahead, hit that like button, turn it black, blue, green, yellow, purple, white, whatever color it turns for you. And we'll do the color of the day is black in remembrance of completion to karma behind me there. And with that, I will catch you guys in the next one. Peace out, homies.